From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, I'm Christopher Muth, Deputy Editor at JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Stephen Salloway, Professor of Psychiatry and Neurology at Warren Alpert Medical School at Brown University, as well as the Associate Director of the Brown Center for Alzheimer Disease Research. Today, we will be discussing two original research articles published in JAMA. The first is titled, Changes in Alzheimer Disease Blood Biomarkers and Associations with Incident All-Cause Dementia by Yifei Liu and colleagues. The second is titled, Blood Biomarkers to Detect Alzheimer Disease in Primary Care and Secondary Care by Sebastian Palmquist and colleagues. Dr. Salloway was also a co-author of an editorial published in JAMA that accompanied these two articles. Thank you for joining us today, Dr. Salloway.
Thank you for having me.
I want to start by discussing what exactly is a biomarker for Alzheimer's disease? What do we mean by that term?
Well, a biomarker generally is a measure of disease or some element of a disease, and it can apply to really many conditions. It's often synonymous with a diagnostic test to help identify a patient who may benefit from treatment or to make a diagnosis. So in this case, we're looking at biological markers of Alzheimer's disease that occur at the time of cognitive impairment or even prior to evidence of cognitive impairment.
Okay, and there's been a long history in the field of Alzheimer's disease research in terms of studying biomarkers. Can you comment about why there has been such a focus historically and now?
Well, I think we're at a transformative time in the diagnosis and treatment of Alzheimer's disease. So these two articles in JAMA are welcome, this new data. It's really been an evolution over time. We know that amyloid plaques and tau tangles are the pathological hallmarks of Alzheimer's disease. And then increasingly over the past 30 years, we've been better able to detect them, first in spinal fluid in the 1990s, then on an amyloid PET scan in the early 2000s, then about 10 years later on a tau PET scan. And until recently, measurement of tau and amyloid protein in the blood, in plasma especially, has been elusive because the levels are very low. But science has advanced. And in one paper that's reported here, a measurement of p-tau 217 as the primary biomarker was very sensitive at detecting amyloid pathology and helping confirm a diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease. So this is a big step forward, and I think it's going to make a big difference in care as we move these biomarkers into clinical practice.
Okay, great. I want to get to that, but first I wanted to start with talking about one of the articles, the article by Liu and colleagues, which explores how biomarkers evolve over time, even before the onset of dementia-related symptoms. This particular study was an analysis of prospectively collected data from about 1,500 adults from the Atherosclerosis Risk in Community Study, or ERIC study. The authors essentially looked at plasma biomarkers collected in midlife and late life, and followed the participants to assess whether they developed all-cause dementia. And they found that Alzheimer's disease-specific biomarkers in midlife were associated with the development of dementia in late life. They also found that at the late life time point, AD-specific biomarkers, but also more general markers of neurodegeneration were associated with all-cause dementia. What do you see as some of the more interesting or important takeaways of this study?
Well, this is a very important data set where they followed individuals, including a large proportion of African-American individuals, over a number of decades. And they had biomarkers that were retrospectively analyzed, as you said, in midlife, especially Alzheimer's-specific biomarkers. So that's, in this case, the isomer was p-tau 181, not 217, as I mentioned in the other study from Sweden. p-tau 181 and a ratio of amyloid beta 42 over amyloid beta 40. And they found that in midlife, and again, these were mild changes, but that elevation or changes in these biomarkers were predictive of late life dementia. And what that means to me is that as we move earlier in detection and earlier in preventative and risk reduction strategies, I see us eventually being able to detect who's at risk for Alzheimer's disease many years, decades really, in midlife before the onset of symptoms, and then being able to institute either risk reduction and or biological treatments that modify that risk. So we can't take these results directly now into testing people at midlife with large-scale screening, but what it does, it gives us a clue that we will be able to as our precision increases and the sensitivity of our measures improves so that we can tell who is on the pathway to developing Alzheimer's disease many years before there's any impairment. So that's really exciting, but it's a little bit futuristic, but really exciting.
Yeah, I think it's been a long time coming with all of this study on how biomarkers evolve. And like you said, there's definitely potential for the future. I wanted to move to the second article that's published in JAMA now, which I think deals more with patients who are actively presenting with cognitive symptoms. This is the article by Palmquist and colleagues, in which they evaluated a specific plasma biomarker test for identifying Alzheimer's disease pathology and looked at how it performed in primary care as well as specialty care settings of patients who were symptomatic when they were presenting to the clinic.
This is a very exciting result from Palmquist, and it's building on a series of reports that have shown similar robust findings that in their study, they had two different cohorts in primary care and in specialty care. And they did a clinical evaluation. The clinicians did an evaluation using standard methods and made a diagnosis of Alzheimer's or something else. And then they confirmed it or not with this specific test called the APS2, and which was looking at a ratio of p-tau217 and an amyloid beta ratio in the plasma.
Yes, yeah, I thought it was interesting. Their primary outcome was looking at Alzheimer's disease pathology, which they defined basically based on cerebrospinal fluid biomarker evidence of amyloid and tau as the reference standard. But then they also looked at a clinical diagnosis as well of Alzheimer's disease as a secondary outcome. And then they compared the accuracy of these plasma biomarker tests compared with clinicians' assessment without using any biomarker data. And you could see that the blood biomarker information certainly helped in improving the accuracy.
And that's really exciting. So that means that I don't think this is going to be a standalone test, but it means that clinicians can use this to more accurately diagnose Alzheimer's disease. And this is going to be important as we now have new treatments that lower amyloid protein that require amyloid confirmation prior to treatment to identify people who are most likely to benefit. And we're going to need tests like this. We can do it with PET scans. We can look at amyloid or tau in spinal fluid and in on a PET scan, but they're expensive, slightly invasive, and they're not readily available in many places. But a blood test will become much more, I think, affordable and widely available. So this is a big step forward, and it's just coming into clinical practice. So I think it's very timely that you're covering this so clinicians can become more aware of the options that will become available to them.
And then going hand in hand with that, I thought it was also important to just briefly touch on the potential pitfalls of relying solely on biomarkers for making a clinical diagnosis. It seems that these biomarker tests definitely have to be considered in the appropriate clinical context because a positive result may not necessarily mean that it's only Alzheimer's disease contributing to a given patient's clinical presentation.
Yeah, absolutely. So right now, we recommend that as these tests come in, they will be coming into clinical practice. And there are a few hurdles we need to address. One, ideally, we'll eventually have FDA and CMS approval coverage for these so that there will be greater access. This test uses mass spectrometry in a single lab. The question is that scalable? There are immunoassays that do test the same fragment of tau, which are going to become more widely available. So we'll have to look for the robustness of that data. Right now it looks pretty good, but that's going to, in terms of practicality, that's really important. But we're recommending, as these tests become available, that a clinician, either in primary specialty care, does an evaluation to determine if there's cognitive impairment and if it's likely due to Alzheimer's disease or not, and what the degree of difficulty is, and then consider whether or not to get the blood test to confirm that. And as you say, there can be Alzheimer mimics that really Alzheimer's may not be, even though there may be some amyloid pathology, it may only be a small part of the person's clinical syndrome.
Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, with the anti-amyloid monoclonal antibodies now becoming available for Alzheimer's disease, those studies that led to the approval of those drugs typically required biomarker evidence of Alzheimer's disease on a PET scan. And so the idea potentially would be that these plasma-based biomarkers could be used as well to identify people who might be candidates for treatment with the anti-amyloid monoclonal antibodies. Is that correct?
Well, the FDA label for the two drugs that are currently approved, lecanemab and donanemab, require amyloid confirmation. And as you say, the standard has been to use an amyloid PET scan or spinal fluid analysis. The FDA label is also open to including blood tests as well. So I can see us using these soon to screen people who may be good candidates. And if someone is low on one of these tests, it's unlikely to have amyloid buildup on a PET scan. So a PET scan wouldn't be required in that individual. If someone was really high, they're very likely to be positive on the PET scan. And we'd only need the PET scan if we then needed to follow a change in amyloid buildup over time with treatment. So as with donanemab, your readers may be aware that they used a stopping rule where they got a follow-up amyloid PET scan. The donanemab is very good at lowering amyloid plaque buildup. And once they got below the cutoff considered positive for Alzheimer's, the medicine was stopped. And that paradigm, that protocol, they required a follow-up amyloid PET scan. So clinicians may choose to use that. The FDA left it open in their label that a follow-up PET scan can be obtained and the medicine could be stopped. It's up to the consideration of the prescribing doctor. So the blood test right now is not sensitive enough. We can detect change that goes along with treatment, but not enough yet to guide treatment. And so we may require a PET scan. So the blood test in that scenario may not be a standalone.
I see. Yeah, it certainly seems like an evolving landscape here.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And we're so excited to have these challenges to sort out. And I tell you, the biggest thing, in my opinion, is this is a major advance. This blood test is transformative and will allow primary care to get very actively involved in improving the diagnosis and treatment of Alzheimer's disease, which we desperately need, patients need. But we need, in order for that to be successful, we really need to bring more resources into both primary and specialty care to improve care. So we can't ask overburdened practices to take on a whole new large area of care without more help. And so it's going to require care navigation, you know, dementia nurses. Our whole healthcare systems really have to get our head around this because the blood test is a great step forward. But it has to be accompanied by the resources that clinicians need to deliver the care well.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point and probably a good point to end on as we are looking towards the future about how this is going to impact care of patients. Do you have any other final thoughts or comments?
No, just thank you so much for publishing these important articles and for covering this story. I think it's really an important breaking story for clinical care and represents a real step forward in how we manage Alzheimer's disease.
Great. I'm Christopher Muth, and I've been speaking with Dr. Stephen Salloway about two JAMA articles and an accompanying editorial about blood biomarkers for Alzheimer's disease. You can find a link to the articles in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.